My goodness. Man, thank you so much for pulling out Shout to the Lord. I tell you what, I love a Darlene Check song the same way my grandparents love Fanny Crosby songs. My goodness. Those songs do it for me. Thank you so much. Are you? Okay, good. That'll be helpful to me.
Yes, I know.
That's fine. Totally fine. Ah. Man, I'm glad to be back with you. I really, really enjoyed our week camping. It was amazing. And I have to recommend to you the week of turning all incoming media off. I'll tell you what. Oh, it was good for my heart. Amazing. Like, really challenged me to think about how much notification buzzing I let into my life on a regular basis. It's worth experimenting with, I think. All right. Pray with me. Father in heaven, we want to know you more. That's why we come. That's why we're a part of this community. Many of us were raised in church families and were taught a lot about how important the Bible is. And yet, a lot of us struggle with incorporating the Bible into our lives in a meaningful way. And so I just pray that today and the rest of the series that we're touching on this summer, that you'll do something in our hearts to help kind of push past those obstacles in us and open up the experience of Scripture so that we really do have a more tangible sense of connection with you and a sense of understanding your heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, church is a place of tradition. Churches do anything well, it's traditions. Even churches that say they have no traditions have traditions because we like something that feels comfortable and repeatable and we know how it happens every year. And there's a tradition, it's not an official one, it's not on the church calendar, but it happens every year like clockwork. It happens in the month of February all around church world. And that is this. Good Christians who made the commitment with their New Year's resolution to read the Bible through this year from cover to cover, slam it down in frustration because they've gotten bogged down in the swamp of Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Happens about February, March. And depending on who you are, your reaction is different. Some people are just like, I cannot bear this, and go do something else entirely. And some people, if you're wired up more like me, grit their teeth and power through because good Christians read their Bible. Right? Anybody have that experience? Anyone at all? Am I the only one? No? Okay. So you started with good intentions, right? You did it because you wanted to know the Bible more, to be more familiar with it. You want to be intentional about your spiritual journey. Maybe you even had this idea that you might hear from God. And so you jump in, and then you start getting hosed with measurements for the tabernacle and the geographical survey of which tribe's lands ends at which river and how to present your grain offerings. And you're like, I don't even have grain. Will God take instant oatmeal packets as a substitute? Trying to figure out what to do with all this stuff that stands between you and your commitment to start at the beginning of the Bible and all the stuff that's the good stuff when you get to maybe Psalms and Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the stuff that you know. This kind of experience is really not very good for us. It creates a hurdle. It creates a belief that a lot of Christians I've talked to have that goes something like this. The Bible is something I'm supposed to read. It's something that we've been given to give us a sense of God's guidance and direction, will for our lives. But it's really harder to read and understand than the preacher makes it out to be. And when I read it, I find it to be difficult and confusing. That's not everyone's experience, but it's a story I've heard enough times to know that it's common. And quite frankly, it's a reasonable experience to have. The Bible doesn't read like any other book. It doesn't. And that's because the Bible is not a book. I know, you're thinking to yourself, that's strange. Mark, you have one sitting right there. I know. This leather-bound, gold-leafed, onion-skinned thing in my hand is not a book at all. This thing right here is a library. And when we come to it expecting it to behave like a book, our experience of reading it is complicated and confusing. So we're going to talk a little bit today about what the idea of the Bible being a library means and how that's not just an academic thing, but actually something that can have a profound impact in your spiritual journey. Because if you come to this expecting it to behave like a book and it doesn't, then it's going to hinder your spiritual journey and maybe even your capacity to hear from God. So I've already said, the Bible's not a book, it's a library. That's probably not new to you, but there are some implications that are important. The Bible, the book, the collection you're holding, it's 66 different books, unless you've got a version that was published by a Catholic press. That will include the Apocrypha and the Deuterocanonical books. So it has 73 books. But most of us have one that has 66 books. Those are the ones you memorize if you grew up in the church like I did, memorizing the books of the Bible. This is why I think reading the Bible from cover to cover is generally a really bad idea. It's a terrible thing to recommend to new Christians, and it's generally a bad idea for most of us. Here's why. It's sort of like walking into your public library and deciding that because you don't know where to start, you're going to begin with the A's and read every book until you get to the Z's. Or even more complicated and more like what we do, walking into the public library and deciding that because you don't know where to start, you're going to find the oldest published book in the library and you're going to read all the books in the library in chronological order of publishing date until you get to the end of the library. Now, you would never do that. That's absurd. But that's the way that we come to the Bible. If you're a voracious reader, you might read every book in a small section. In elementary school, in my little Christian elementary school, I read all the biographies in the library. But we were a tiny Christian school with a tiny conservative Christian library. That's a specific kind of library that has specific kinds of books. And I think that it only had about 40 biographies in it. And I was there for 8 grades. So I read them all. Not a big deal. But that doesn't happen for most of us. We don't usually read all the sections. And libraries, when you go to them, they have all these different kinds of books, right? There's magazines, periodicals. There's reference books like encyclopedias and dictionaries and almanacs. There's poetry and fiction and nonfiction. And if you didn't know any of that, if you did not know that the library had all those different kinds of books, and you walked in with your genius plan to read the library from A to Z, and you began, you would be confused, bored, lost, and overwhelmed in no time. That's exactly what happens for many people when they try reading the book from cover to cover. They're trying to read the Bible as if it's a single book that will read all of the same way, all the way through, but it's not. It's a collection of different books written by different people, speaking from different cultures and different circumstances and different times. There's history books that tell about the experiences of the nation of Israel. Now, most of these are not journalistic history the way you and I find history books today. Most of them are editorial history, which means that the stories were collected and put together in a sequence by someone who had a viewpoint they were trying to communicate. Good example. Have you ever read 1st, 2nd Kings and 1st, 2nd Chronicles? Have you noticed that they tell exactly the same stories, but sometimes they have a little bit different take on them? Well, guess what? There's a reason for that. One of them was written by priests, and one of them was written by royal scribes. And they are bringing different viewpoints. The priests are bringing a viewpoint of what is the nation doing to honor God or dishonor God. The royal scribes are bringing the viewpoint of what's historically happening. So those two perspectives bring a different weight to how the stories are told. It's editorial. If you don't know that, then you read 1st and 2nd Kings and 1st and 2nd Chronicles and you put them side by side with each other. You're like, I don't understand. Why is the same story different in two places? Did it happen two different times? Is somebody wrong? What do we do with this? Right? You don't even know that if you're not thinking about the fact that they're coming from different people who brought them together. Then there's the prophetic books. Prophetic, that's a scary word, right? Because prophecy. And some of us have experience with prophecy in a variety of ways in the church. Well, the prophetic books, all they are is collections of sermons. Okay, some of them are pretty hardcore sermons. Some of them are pretty scary sermons. But they're all collections of sermons from a particular prophet to a particular group of people about a particular circumstance that is happening among them that God wants to speak into. And when you understand that, that begins to make them a little less scary and a little more open to the possibility of reading them to apply to us today. There's collections of civil and religious laws for the nation of Israel. There are books of wisdom like Proverbs that collect poems and aphorisms that are meant to give guidance for daily living. And then there's the Psalms, the biggest book in the Bible. It's a collection of poetry and songs, most of which are written for use in public worship. Then there's letters. Some of them are individual letters written to specific people. Most of them are letters written to groups of people. All the letters were written by someone specific, to someone specific, in a specific circumstance. We get to the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, probably the most important books for us as followers of Jesus. And they look like biographies, but once again, they are not modern-day biographies that are meant to be a tell-all about that person's life. They are editorial biographies. Each of them is written by somebody who knew Jesus, speaking to a certain group of people, telling them something about who Jesus is for them. And so as we've been studying the Gospel of John, you've noticed as we've gone through the Gospel of John how the Gospel of John is great for us. But when you really understand the author and the group it was written to, you can see that it's a group of people living at the extreme end of the timeline from when Jesus came. People who had not witnessed Jesus themselves. People who had been kicked out of the synagogue. People who no longer had the temple as the source, as the center point of their religion. When you understand that, you begin to understand why the Gospel of John is walking through the entire Jewish ritual and saying, nope, we don't need ritual cleanliness. Nope, we don't have to make the sacrifices. Nope, we don't have to go to a temple to worship. Why is that in there? Well, because that's what we need, but also because the people it was written to were wrestling with that very issue. Who are we going to be as followers of Jesus without the temple, without the synagogue, without our historic religious tradition? Who are we going to be? And that's a different audience than the Gospel of Mark. When you understand these things, stuff bubbles to the surface that you might never have seen before. And then there's a couple of books that are a kind of literature called apocalyptic. Primarily Daniel and Revelation, although there's some apocalyptic sections in other books. Now, apocalyptic is a very unique kind of ancient literature. It's not around today. And basically, it's a symbolic literature that was developed in times of persecution, religious persecution, to communicate religious information in a way where you wouldn't get killed for it. Right? So when you have comments to say about the ruling government around you, and you want to say things about that government that are maybe not supported by the government, the apocalyptic was a way to write about those people and what God is doing in a way that was masked or hidden. The revelation means the revealing. Well, when you understand that, you begin to read those things in a completely different way. Well, not only are there a wide variety of books in this collection that we have, but some of the books themselves have a variety of literature in the book itself. In the very same place, you'll have a historical, factual account of an event that happened, and then in another place, you'll have a traditional story that was passed down by oral tradition, and those two kinds of stories have different expectations of reading. If I'm telling you a story in a journalistic fashion, the details are about what happened. If I'm telling you one of these traditional tales, the details are about a larger truth. And then there's parables. Parable, that's a word we've grown up in the church with, right? Well, you know what a parable is? Get this, parable's just a religious word for a fictional story meant to tell a spiritual truth. So Jesus told fictional stories. That sounds weird to my childhood upbringing, right? He told fictional stories that communicated real truth. That's a genre that's in the Bible. And then there's prayers and hymns. There's personal notes. There's at least one grocery list. All across the Bible, a wide variety of types of literature. Now, somebody here in our group today is wondering, okay, Mark, why does that even matter? That's interesting. It's academic. This isn't a college class. I just want to read the Bible and have God's guidance for my life. Why does this matter to me? Here is why it matters. You read different kinds of books differently if you want to understand them. You know that's true already in your practical life. Think about our public library trip again. Go back there in your mind. You're walking up to the reference shelves. Maybe you're interested in looking up the average temperature in July in Oregon in the last 100 years. Just wondering if this is normal, right? Or maybe you're looking up the political ramifications of the Crimean War. Or maybe you want a synonym for the word passive aggressive, right? You've got some specific piece of information you want to know. And so you're going to go to a reference book that's about that domain, and you're going to look up that information. So when you're reading in that setting, how are you going to read? Are you going to read cover to cover? Are you going to read slowly, taking in every line in sequence? No. What are you going to do? You're going to flip pages. You're going to scan quickly. You're going to look for exactly the information that you want. Right? That's a kind of reading for reference. But then maybe you go into the fiction section. And it's summertime, and you're heading out camping, and you want a great story, a rich, deep story that's going to captivate you and make you think. And so you find that, and when you sit down, how are you going to read it? Are you going to flip pages back and forth and scan quickly up and down the lines and jump around? No. You're going to read it deeply, carefully, in sequence, one page after another as you sink into the story. Now imagine going into the fiction section and reading one of those books as if they're an encyclopedia. What's the outcome of that going to be? You're going to be confused. You're going to end up with wrong information. Or reverse it. Maybe you go to the almanac and you try and read it like a novel. What's that experience going to be like? Boring? Possibly confusing? You won't find a plot because there isn't one? See, this stuff I'm telling you, this is not new. It's not fancy biblical interpretation. It's common sense. You know intuitively, if you want to understand the book you're reading, you have to read it according to the kind of book it is. Now, you might not have realized in your upbringing with the Bible that the Bible is also a library, and this exact same intuition applies. If you're reading the Bible in order to understand it, and I hope to God that's the reason why you're reading it, if you're reading it in order to understand it, you need to start here. Actually, I think I want to do a quick aside on that statement, if you're reading the Bible in order to understand it. There are a lot of reasons why we read the Bible, friends. You've grown up in the church. There are lots of reasons, and a pretty good handful of them are not helpful for you. Some of us read the Bible out of obligation, because good Christians do what? Read the Bible, right? Good Christians can tell you how many times they read the Bible through from cover to cover, right? Good Christians actually have Bibles that demonstrate in physical ways that they read the Bible a lot. Right? So you almost feel ripped off if you have multiple editions at home and you read one and then you go to the other and you maybe have this feeling like, oh man, I really should be reading from that one so that it gets worn and starts to have that, like, you know, pillar of the church saint look that's all worn and the pages all open exactly right. Right? You know, that thing that's in your heart if you grew up in the church is reading the Bible from obligation, and it does nothing for your spiritual life. It does nothing for your relationship with God. Some of us read the Bible because of legalism. We believe, maybe haven't articulated this, but we believe deep, deep down in the back of our spiritual brain that reading the Bible is part of the cost of salvation and God's favor. It's hard to do. It's sort of like eating lima beans, but it's part of the deal. It's part of the cost. And maybe we suspect deep down in the back corners of our brain that God won't really bless us if we don't know the Bible well. I mean, we've been told, right, that story where Jesus meets Satan in the wilderness and Jesus fends off Satan with what? Bible quotes, right? And so we've been told as kids growing up in the church that this is going to be your defense. Know Scripture, right? Know it. And so we're feeling like, I'm going to be really hosed if Satan appears to me and offers whatever, right? And we secretly believe that other Christians who can rapidly quote chapter and verse are maybe a little bit more spiritual than we are. We covered that a few weeks ago. Christians who can rapidly quote chapter and verse, all they're revealing is that they went to church school. That's all that means. It doesn't reflect on their relationship with God. It doesn't reflect on their spiritual journey. It doesn't mean they're more spiritually mature than you. They could be, because the Bible is a powerful tool God uses. But just because someone can memorize where things are at and remember them and remember the addresses, it means nothing about your spiritual journey. And so if we're reading the Bible because of those reasons, we plow through it, even if we don't understand it, because we're just trying to get time in, right? That's reading the Bible for legalistic reasons, and it undermines any spiritual value you might find in it. Okay, let's go a little bit deeper, a little more uncomfortable. Some of us read the Bible because we need to be right. The Bible's an authority. It's a spiritual authority. Many of us grew up in communities where the Bible was held in enormously high esteem. And if you know the Bible really well, then some of that esteem sort of rains down on you, right? And you have a position of affirmation in the community. Some of us have personal stories that have led us to believe that being right is a kind of security. It's a kind of strength. And maybe we even have an unarticulated belief in the back of our minds that being right about Bible issues, about doctrine, maybe that honors God and kind of protects God's reputation a bit. So we read the Bible in order to be right. And what that looks like is we read it to back up our theology. I've told you before about a Bible edition that I have at home that I got during college. And if you go through it, it's got lots and lots of color-coded underlining. And if you open the front cover, the key of the colored underlining is different theological questions. That I was reading the Bible looking specifically for passages that supported theology that was important to me, or that I was more passionate about undermined theological views that I disagreed with. We read the Bible to back up our theology or in order to have arguments, in order to have ammunition for arguments about what God approves of and what God doesn't approve of. Okay, when we read the Bible this way, we fill our mind with knowledge and artificially inflate our spirit with pride. That is what happens every time. The Bible itself isn't God or God's Spirit. The Bible itself, if you approach it with the need to be right, can be the very thing that fuels your self-righteousness and sin. Here's another one. This one's tricky. It sounds good. Some of us read the Bible looking for hope. Okay, we believe in God. We've come to a place in our journey where we believe that the Bible is God's word and that God speaks to us. But the kind of divine word that we're looking for is mostly encouragement. Now, wanting encouragement from God is not a bad thing. But when we read the Bible for this reason, what we tend to do is we stick to the highlights. We read the top 10. You know, we read the 23rd Psalm and 1 Corinthians 13 and the stories of Jesus, and we find passages that sound, when you read them, when you pull that passage out like a precious diamond and put it on a shelf, they sound like promises written to us. And we read them in that light. But when we read the Bible that way, with a predominant expectation of looking for hope, what we're doing is biblically justified wish fulfillment. We have a lens that we're looking through. It's kind of like having a conversation with your significant other, but only listening when they say nice things about you. It's not a real conversation. It's certainly not a conversation that leads to deep relationship. If our purpose is to know God more, and that we come to the Bible desiring to know God through the Bible and hear the Bible as God's word to us, then we need to read it to understand it. And if your desire is to read the Bible to understand it, then, my friends, we have to read the Bible for what it is, not for what we wish it was. Whenever you're reading a passage, a story, a chapter, a verse, you need to start with what it is, not what you hope it is. And part of that is understanding this whole library concept that I'm talking about today. You see, one of the things this means, the library, is that not every verse in the Bible is the same. All verses in the Bible don't carry the same weight. All verses in the Bible can't be read in exactly the same way. That means that every type of writing in the Bible, these different genres I've talked about, they require a different kind of attention, a different kind of listening, a different kind of reading. Okay, this is a big topic, something we could talk about for hours and hours and hours, and that would be a college class. But I want to give you four quick applications that will help you in your journey to hear God more. First, just simply start by being aware of this fact. We've had this conversation today. Keep it in mind. Be aware of this fact when you read the Bible. When you read the Bible, don't expect it to behave like a book. When you read the Bible, don't expect it to read all the same all the way through. Expect to bring different reading skills to it as you go through it. Without doing anything else, without learning a single other thing, this awareness will do something important for you. It might even do it for you right now. This will help you let go of any guilt or baggage you might have around not loving every single part of the Bible. Take that and let it go. Have you ever heard a preacher say that? Does that sound freeing? Let me say it again. It is okay to not love every single part of the Bible. You're not supposed to love a list of instructions for how to build a building. You're not supposed to love a geographical survey of whose tribal land starts and ends where in a country that you don't live in a tribe you're not a part of. You're not supposed to love passages that detail the horrible treatment of human beings. You're not supposed to love every single thing that's in the Bible. You are not a bad Christian for noticing that different parts of the Bible impact you differently. They should impact you differently because they're different. They're different kinds of literature with different kinds of purposes. Just notice that. Be aware of it. Number two, notice the genre when you read it. Genre is a technical literature word. It simply means a certain form of writing that has its own assumptions, conventions, and style. Not complicated. You've all written letters in your life. I know we mostly don't do that now with email, but even with an email, there's sort of different kinds of email. And if you write a personal letter to a friend that you've known for many years, that letter is going to have a tone. You're going to use certain vocabulary. It's going to have a style. That letter is going to be markedly different from the cover letter for your resume as you apply for the job you really want. They're going to be different in tone and style and vocabulary. Those are two different genres of letters. You all know that they're meant to be read differently. You all know that they're written differently for different purposes. Okay, just be aware of that reality when you come to the Bible. Even if you don't know much about this stuff, even if you don't know much about genres, you can tell some basics. You're reading a verse in the Bible. Is the verse you're reading in a letter? If it's in a letter, what does that mean? There was a letter writer, there was a letter receiver, and the letter was written in a circumstance. Just that alone, that tiny little piece of information gives you an incredible insight into what's going on in the letter. Is the text you're reading in a book of poetry? Why might that be important? Well, poetry uses symbols to communicate truth. Poetry uses things like metaphors and similes and parallelisms and comparisons. We do not expect poems to be scientifically precise. We don't read poetry that way. So if the verse you're reading is in a poem, consider that the poet might have been meaning to convey something bigger than particular details. Very often, if you don't know, very often in your edition of the Bible, there's an introduction page with each book. And that introduction page will tell you a little bit about who wrote the book or who we think wrote it and when it was written and who it was written to. That introduction page should give you some clues about the genre if they don't tell you outright. And even if you don't have that, you can pick up clues in the text as you read it. You're smart people. So look around the verse. Look before, look after. Is someone telling a story? If they're telling a story, are they reciting a historical event like, hey, this is what happened yesterday, da-da-da-da-da-da? Or are they telling a story that's clearly meant to be an illustration, like once upon a time there was a? Those are two different kinds of stories, meant to be read differently. Are they giving an illustration? Is it a sermon? Is it a poem? Just noticing these things as you read will begin to shift your mind as you pay attention to Scripture. Third thing, if you're willing and have time and are willing to go deeper, learn a bit more about the library. You don't have to be a biblical scholar with years and years of school to know this stuff, to know enough to impact your reading. Just knowing that this exists puts you miles ahead of people. But I can tell you from personal experience, learning this stuff was transformative for me in coming to understand meaning in Scripture. Many times as I've preached through the Bible with you, and you've come up afterwards and gone, man, that was really amazing, that insight. Many times those insights come from this exact study. What is this book about? Who is it written to? What was going on when it was written? How do these things link together? Our entire series of John, and you have all been so gracious about how that has been positive for you. Our entire series of John is built out of this very question. What is going on in this book that we don't see just reading at first glance? If you're interested in learning a little bit more, a great starting point is a little book I recommended once before by Gordon Fee called Reading the Bible for All It's Worth. There's a link to it on the front page of the church website, the new website I mentioned earlier. You can go check it out. It's easy to read. It's accessible. It'll walk you through this conversation about the literary genres in the Bible. It'll give you some basics of first century culture for the New Testament and Hebrew culture for the Old Testament. Basic stuff that everybody who reads the Bible ought to understand. It's the kind of stuff that lies at the root when you're watching TV and some politician makes some ridiculous biblical statement. They quote the Bible text, and in your gut, you're like, that's insane. Like, has that person even read the Bible? The reason that they say the thing they said is because they are not having this conversation. They're pulling out a verse because it serves their purposes. They're divorcing it from how it was written and where it was found. And when you come back to how it was written and where it was found, you have sort of bumper guards that keep you in line with the intention. And I think God works through that. All right, last thing. Finally, this is a little bit of a behavior change for all of us to help us keep this in mind. When you think and talk about the Bible, relate to it as a library. Easiest one. This is something we do around here, around the church, all the church. Somebody says in conversation or from here, the Bible says. Okay. I'm not impugning anyone. I've said that myself. But that statement is always incomplete and many times misleading. The Bible doesn't say anything because the Bible is a collection of books. God speaks through all of it. So we could say God says, or I believe God says. But when we say the Bible says, what that is it's a claim of authority without identifying the source. Okay? It's like saying, well, the boss told me I could. That's all it is. It's a claim of authority. It's not entirely honest. It's a little bit like saying, well, the library says, right? I mean, if you say the library says, what you mean is this piece of information is in the library. But there's lots of stuff in the library. There's current, accurate, wonderful stuff. There's poetry. There's fiction. There's all kinds of things. Without that other piece of information, saying the library says is not helpful. So when you say the Bible says, here's what you're implying, whether you mean it or not. You're implying that every part of the Bible is the same. Every part of the Bible speaks with exactly the same voice, and every part of the Bible carries exactly the same weight. And that is not true. It does not matter how conservative a Christian or how liberal a Christian you are. It doesn't matter whether you believe in plenary verbal inspiration or whether you're crazy liberal, barely hanging on by the skin of your teeth to the fact that the Bible is worth something. It doesn't matter where you fall on that line. The words of Jesus in the Gospels are not the same in meaning and significance as the geographical survey in the book of Deuteronomy. They are simply not. And to pretend otherwise is to ignore the Bible itself, what the Bible teaches us about how to read the Bible. So let's be honest and accurate. Let's say things like, the book of Hebrews says, or the Apostle John wrote, or Jesus said. Oh no, please, for God's sake, when you say Jesus said, actually quote Jesus' words. You cannot believe how many people say Jesus said and then randomly quote something in the Bible that has nothing to do with Jesus. Now, the theological justification for that is the Bible is inspired by God, Jesus is God, therefore everything in the Bible Jesus said. Okay, but when you say Jesus said, what people are hearing you say is the historical person of Jesus that Christians believe and follow said these words. And if that's not what you're actually saying when you say Jesus said, then you're not telling the truth. So just say, Jesus said, stuff that Jesus said. And then say about the other stuff, whatever it is. The book of Leviticus says, right? Saying the book of Leviticus says has considerably different weight than saying the Bible says. It's also considerably more accurate. Now, none of this means that the Bible is not inspired. I believe the Bible is inspired. None of this means that there aren't clear themes and messages that proceed throughout all of the books of the Bible. None of this means that these ancient books can't speak relevantly to our lives today. But instead of seeing the Bible as a single monolithic whole, we come to see Scripture differently. God is big enough to have used different people in different times, in different cultures, in different situations, writing in different literary genres to communicate God's truth to us. Learning that does not have to be an obstacle to your faith. It does not have to undermine your belief that the Bible is inspired. In fact, I'm going to suggest to you as we close that this view is more in keeping with the character of God as it's revealed in the Bible. Here's what I mean. When I was a young child, walking into my dad's study was a compelling and fascinating experience. It was a small square room, I think maybe about 12 feet square, if I remember right. In the middle of the room, in the actual middle, not against the wall, was a large metal desk, the sort you imagine is in a principal's office somewhere. And all four walls, the entire surface of the room was bookshelves. The first shelf was the floor, and it went all the way from floor to ceiling, every wall, from wall to wall to wall. The only breaks at all were for the window and for the door. The shelves were covered wall to wall to wall to wall to floor to ceiling with books. It was certainly multiple hundreds of volumes, maybe a couple thousand volumes. I don't really know. It's like the room was built from books. And you walk in and it has that book smell. And the sound is deadened. The outside world sound is deadened by the weight of the books. And it felt like this silent sanctuary. I spent hours and hours and hours in my early life just browsing in my dad's study. My dad was a pastor, so of course there were multiple series of commentaries and other reference books. There were selections of different Bible versions. That's the place that I learned that there were actually different kinds of Bibles that said different things. There were books on leadership and marriage and parenting. There were books on theology. There were college textbooks. There were books on topics that my dad was researching. There were books on backpacking and photography in the mountains of Colorado. There were biographies and histories in this one really cool book I can still remember so clearly. It was this beautiful brown embossed book called Character Sketches. It was hundreds of pages. It was like this thick. And every two-page spread started with a pencil sketch of a Bible character and then everything we know from the Bible about that person. Just like every named person in the Bible in this book. I spent hours reading that book, looking at the pictures. Almost all of my dad's books were marked up. He was vigorous with a pen in his books. Asterisks that had energy, underlining, multiple underlines, depending on how important that line of text was. You know, sort of one underline for this is interesting, multiple scratchy underlines back and forth for this is a really big deal. And there was my dad's terrible handwriting scribbles in the margins, asking questions, arguing with the author, making comments. Some of the books were worn, clearly read multiple times. Surveying the books on the shelves of my dad's study sketched a picture of who he was. So each book, these certain lines underlined, him having arguments with the author in the margin of the text. Each book was a puzzle piece giving insight into what was going on in his mind and his heart. They weren't all the same. There was no single volume that said, this is uniformly who your dad is and what he thinks on every subject. That book did not exist. All the books weren't religious. All the books weren't even from the same viewpoint. There were topics that my dad was researching that were controversial in the church at the time, and he had books from every angle, from every side of the argument. And yet, taken together, this library gave a remarkably clear picture of who he was. Some of us want the Bible to be a single, unified, monolithic whole. We want sparkling clarity where every verse agrees perfectly with every other verse and they all work seamlessly together to paint a perfectly clear picture of God and God's will for us. That is what we want. That is not what the Bible is. This experience right here, a single bound book with every book in the same font and typeface so that it conveys the image that it's all one thing. This experience began with the Reformation. It began with the printing press and Gutenberg. It began with the Reformers, Wycliffe and Luther. The experience the church had of the Bible before that was every one of these as an individual document, a separate book on a shelf with a separate author's name. The early church If you went into the early church and you were in a church that was big enough and old enough to have a place, they would have a shelf of scripture. That came from their heritage in the Jewish synagogue, where in the Jewish synagogue there was a place where the Torah was kept, right? And the early Christian church would have this place where the books they had would be kept. They were handwritten, all of them. They didn't have them all, but the ones they had on their shelf. They had the Gospel according to John, and they had a couple of Paul's letters, and they had a copy of the five books of Moses. They had a handful of books, individual books. And I wonder sometimes if our experience of God's Word would be more powerful if our experience was still that way. Because this tricks us into treating the Bible like it's a book like any other book, and it is simply not that. The Bible is a collection of books written by a variety of different people over a long span of time in three different languages, shaped by a variety of different cultures, written in and written to countless different circumstances. That's the truth. And some of us fear that accepting that as true will undermine the Bible's authority for us or cheapen its portrayal of God's will. I believe this is just not the case. The Bible, seen as it is, gives us a remarkable picture of God's character and how God works. You see, God works slowly across time because God is not into coercion. God worked through broken people in a broken world because God does not require people to be perfect to be used by God. God even worked through outcomes that are not ideal. Right? There's stuff in here that's hard. There's stuff in here where you have two passages side by side that fight with each other that seem like one must be right and one must not be. How do we deal with that? If I was the one writing the Bible, it would not be that way. It would be crystal clear. It would have bullet points. Everything would be cross-referenced and it would all agree. But God chose an imperfect outcome because God is big enough to get his will done without a perfect outcome. God spoke through different kinds of people using different kinds of literature because God honors the individuality of the humans he created. Not just you, but the humans God used to write the book. Have you ever considered the implications of some of the views of inspiration that we have on the people that God chose to use to write the Bible? Have you ever considered? We believe, most of us, I'm not Calvinist, we believe that God gave us free will. That free will is a significant part of our identity before God. It's how we choose to enter into relationship with God, and it's something that God will honor in us into eternity. We believe that, like, that's a central theological point. Well, did the people that God chose to work through to write the Bible not have free will? Did God paralyze them? Did God wipe out their personalities, their stories, their history, so that none of that could impact what might happen here? No, because that is not the way God works. God chooses to work through people. People have stories. People have background. People live in cultures at specific places in time. And even the people that wrote the texts that are the Bible, God worked through them because God is big enough to honor the individuality of all the people that he worked through. You see, the words of the Bible tell us a story. That's what I was raised to understand. Understand the words of the Bible and the story they tell. But the construction of the Bible tells us a story too. That story is a story of God working gently through many broken people in a profoundly broken world, gracefully navigating through our human tools in order to reach us, to draw us to Christ, and to give us new life. The Bible is not just where we learn about grace. The Bible itself, in how it came to us and how it is formed, is a stunning act of grace. Pray with me. Father, I want to know you more. I want to know your heart and your character. And one of the primary tools you've given me for that journey is the scripture. I want to handle it well with integrity. I want to honor it. I want to submit myself to it. And I want to do all of that in a way that's intelligent, that uses the mind that you've given me, and I know that my friends here in this room feel the same way. And so I pray that you will help us see the Bible in ways that are compelling, that draw us in, that give us an excitement and enthusiasm to spend time understanding it, studying it, meditating on it, and that that tool will continue to bear fruit in our lives as we come to know your character, your heart for us, and the way that you work. I pray that you be with my friends this week. as they go out into the world this busy summer where we're all so spread apart, that that you will help them see opportunities to be the church, to love people, to give grace, to give support, to share your heart. Thank you so much for your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen.